Welcome to Batangas, where we're making the most of the remaining days of cool weather to enjoy the lakeside towns before the scorching heat of summer begins.
In this episode, we travel to the historic town of Taal to reveal its heritage and revel in its past. Then we'll take a side trip to Alitagtag for an overnight stay on a cliff overlooking the mountains of Batangas and the islands of Lake Taal.
So join us, I'm David Celdran. This is Executive Class.
It's my first time in the historic center of Taal in maybe 3 decades. And apart from the traffic and new buildings, it's hard to tell I've been away that long because so much looks the same, at least in the poblacion. Taal, after all, is best known as the heritage town of Batangas and the so-called Vigan of the South because of its colonial-era streetscape, which, like those in the Ilocano City, have managed to survive both revolutions and urbanization, not to mention deadly earthquakes. With the Taal volcano so dangerously close, the town named after it has had more calamities to deal with over the centuries, including, most recently, the heavy ashfall of 2020. In fact, the original 16th century town of Taal was situated closer to the lake, but a major eruption in 1754 forced locals to flee to its current location on a hill overlooking Balayan Bay. With the Taal straddling both sea and lake, the town grew to become a wealthy trading port, grand mansions, and monumental churches that reflected its colonial era stature.
If there's one landmark most people associated with Taal, it's this one, the 16th century Basilica of Taal, said to be the largest Catholic church in Asia.
Built in 1856 on high ground above the historic center, the current Basilica of St. Martin of Tours looks even taller and larger than it already is. Like the previous basilicas, which were built on the lake and which were both destroyed by eruptions and earthquakes, the current church was most recently damaged in a series of temblors in 2017, but has reopened since. Luckily, most of the historic bahay na bato homes that give Taal its unique character have withstood the calamities of the past, though sadly, many have been demolished to make way for new commercial buildings. As of last count, there are under 100 ancestral homes left standing in the poblacion. But the good news is, the grandest and most important of these have been preserved and reopened to the public.
The great thing about Taal is that it's an entirely walkable town with pretty much ancestral homes everywhere you look. Some of them more interesting than others, like this one. This one is a home of Don Gregorio Agoncillo, one of the wealthiest Taaleños, if not Batangueños.
Also called the White House, the American colonial-style Agoncillo mansion is among the largest in Taal. A private tour gives visitors a peek into the lives of Taal's turn-of-the-century elites.
Wow, will you look at this space? Clearly the Agoncillos weren't just extremely wealthy. They were also well-connected politically. You see, Gregorio's sister, Maria, was the second wife of President Aguinaldo.
Mm-hmm. Further downtown is another famous historic Agoncillo home in Taal, now a public museum and national shrine. Marcela Agoncillo, who made the Philippine national flag, and her husband Felipe, a prominent diplomat, used to live in this 18th century Spanish-era Bahay na Bato structure, the oldest of its kind in Taal. However, not all ancestral homes in Taal are as old or large or once occupied by rich and famous locals. But each one has an interesting story to tell, and each and every one is lovely to photograph.
Because so many of the old streets are so photogenic, Taal has become a prime destination for photographers as well. In fact, they come here for another photographic landmark, one of the best vintage camera museums in the country.
The Galeria Taal is more than just a beautifully preserved structure. The ancestral home of the Ilagan clan is also the country's first and most complete vintage camera museum, with rare models dating back to the 19th century.
These are examples of the kinds of cameras that were used to take photographs like these, historical photographs of landmark events in Philippine history. The execution of the 13 martyrs, 13 martyrs, Dr. Jose Rizal's execution, and of course, these famous portraits of Filipino heroes and ilustrados. Yes, this is my favorite room. This is where you find vintage Nikon cameras from Japan, including some rare rangefinders. And of course, what everyone kind of comes here for. The owner's Leica camera collection. These would cost a fortune.
Assembled from the private camera collection of Manny Innumerable, a descendant of the Ilagans, the museum also houses historic photographs memorializing key personalities and events in Taal and around the country. If you're in the mood to travel back in time to photograph historic moments in Taal, you can do so at the Casa de Cuerdos, a restored ancestral home converted into a photo studio where you can pick out a character to recreate. Anyone from a Spanish friar to a revolutionary officer.
So let's go with a local ilustrado, okay? Like a rich man who owned one of these houses in Taal town. This is probably what he'd be wearing, sort of.
Truly, there are so many ways to relive Taal's history. Pretty much everywhere you look or turn.
Despite the presence of cars, motorcycles, and telephone wires, it's still possible to imagine Taal the way it was maybe a century or two ago. But not just with the architecture, but also with the cuisine. The Paradores del Castillo houses a hotel and restaurant where the ancestral home of the Del Castillo family used to be.
Built in the 1900s in the Spanish-American colonial style, the newly restored hotel offers one of the best accommodations and restaurants in Taal. Ernie Villavicencio is the current owner of the property and the descendant of one of Taal's most prominent families. His Paradores is one of 8 historic buildings he's rescued and restored so far.
I felt that one of the ways wherein I could help my town is by promoting tourism, okay, in our town. Being a heritage town, okay, I got disappointed that there were houses that were being demolished left and right. Yes. So I made it my personal mission to restore the houses. Mm. And once the houses are restored, repurpose the houses into commercial
use.
Thereby, once you do that, you can then attract tourists to come in here.
Tourists, of course, need a place to sleep. and eat. His paradores gives guests a chance to live and dine like a local ilustrado, with period authentic furnishings and an al fresco garden restaurant that serves farm and lake fresh ingredients cooked and prepared the Taaleño way.
This is the main,
this is really great.
The pride of Taal, the Malipoto.
So wow, this is like the star of the show.
Yeah, basically the Malipoto is the star of our show. Okay, you can either have it grilled, as we are doing right now, or sinigang. It's very fleshy, it's a very fleshy type of fish. Again, you can only find this in Taal Lake, okay? We'll try it.
Lucky for me, the rare fish is in season. As is another rare fish that's found only in Taal Lake, tawilis. Deep fried and yummy.
This and the fried tawilis, okay, are basically the star of our show, as I was saying. Okay, this is typical Taal food. Adobo sa dilaw, tapang Taal, fried tawilis, grilled malipoto. Those are basically when you talk about Taal cuisine.
Indeed, because Taal is still surrounded by farms, there's no shortage of fresh ingredients, like pork for the Taal longaniza and tapang Taal, chicken and turmeric for the adobo sa dilaw, and rice for the sumang Taal, and of course, seafood from Balayan Bay and fish from Taal Lake. With Paradores del Castillo as an example, Ernie hopes to show other families from Taal, even outsiders, that converting abandoned ancestral homes for tourism can help them recover the high cost of restoring and maintaining these old structures. An amount, he says, that ranges from 5 to 20 million pesos, depending on the size and condition of their property.
There are smaller houses that you can get for about 5 million and everything, but you have to spend at least 5 to 7, 8 million. So it's going to be between 10 to 20 million per house.
Maybe we can check out some of these houses.
Yeah. Maybe I can sell you one of the houses.
Just check out the houses. Okay.
Now, we would love to have you as our neighbor. I'm sure you'll be able to promote Taal.
20 million? Maybe I'll stick to promoting Taal through the show instead. Though in recent years, more and more investors have been acquiring old houses in town and converting them into boutique hotels, cafes, and vacation homes. When we return, we'll visit some of these restored ancestral homes, plus a charming farmhouse bed and breakfast for vacationing amidst the most stunning views of Taal Lake. Welcome back to Executive Class in the heritage town of Taal in Batangas. I'm traveling back in time with one of the heirs of the prominent Villavicencio clan, who, along with a growing number of entrepreneurial conservationists, have been acquiring and restoring some of the town's abandoned historic buildings and converting them into commercial spaces and vacation homes.
So a lot of these old homes are actually just close to each other, right?
Yes, that's why it's the poblacion area. Okay, this is the Gopo house that you see there.
Up here, is this an inn? Or
this is my great-grandmother. She was considered the angel of the revolution, the forgotten heroine of the Philippine Revolution, named by Emilio Aguinaldo.
Doña Gliceria Marella was married to another prominent Taaleño and revolutionary figure, Don Eulalio Villavicencio, whose home, now Ernie's residence, is one of the best restored Bahay na Bato structures in town and open to visitors.
More or less, this was built pre-1850, so it's about 173 years old right now, more or less. Come on, let's enter.
So how much of the house is the original structure?
I would say 80-90%.
Not bad.
There are less than 100 of these ancestral homes left in town, and only a handful are as well preserved as Casa Villavicencio, This faithfully restored colonial-style bahay na ba to showcases the best features of the vernacular architecture, with high ceilings and large capiz windows all across to cool the home. It's green architecture before it was in vogue, with a view of the tree line, a portion of Balayan Bay, and a neighbor's home.
You look out your windows like you're...
There's a better view.
It's there. One century ago.
Yeah, and that's how they make legal to one another.
Just across the street.
That's their cell phone system.
Of course, not everyone lived this grandly. The Villavicencios were shipping magnates, and their large house was built on a tall hill, so they could see ships ferrying goods from Manila arriving on the bay. Naturally, wealthy homes like theirs were decorated with the finest furniture and finishings available at the time, all of which were carefully restored or recreated by artisans commissioned by Ernie. Most impressive of which is the original printed wallpaper and the tin ceiling from Belgium, an expensive attempt by Ernie's ancestors to westernize a space for American Governor F.B. Harrison's overnight stay here.
From a traditional bahay na bato, it became an Art Nouveau house.
Apart from the architectural significance of Casa Villavicencio, the home is also celebrated for the clandestine meetings of the Katipunan that took place here. Andres Bonifacio was said to have hid in the basement below, which is surprising because the Spanish authorities requisitioned the family's second home next door in order to spy on the Villavicencio couple, whom they suspected of aiding Katipuneros. Called the wedding gift house today, the Bahay na Bato was so called because it was Eulalio Villavicencio's gift to his wife Liceria on their wedding day. Similar in size and layout as their first residence, the second Villavicencio home inherited by Ernie's cousins was redecorated in a more feminine style to reflect the romance that inspired its origin as a wedding gift. Like Casa Villavicencio, the home is open to the public and a popular backdrop for period films.
There's a reason why these homes look so familiar, and they do look familiar, right? And that's because a lot of teleseries and movies are filmed in these ancestral homes of Taal, which is why Taal has a new nickname, Taaliwood.
Indeed, many parts of the poblacion resemble a movie set made to look like a turn-of-the-century town. Except here, all the old buildings are authentic.
Lucky for visitors, a lot of the ancestral homes in Taal are open to the public. In fact, you can even spend the night in some of them, such as this one. Hello? Anyone home?
Hi,
hey,
David!
Hey there! Wow, this is so nice.
Welcome to Posada La Patriciana.
Posada La Patriciana is a restored bahay na bato transformed into a residence and bed and breakfast by Mike and Patty Rodriguez, out-of-towners who fell in love with Taal's architectural heritage.
So tell me about this home. How did you find it? How did you restore it?
Yeah, well, it started off with just an expressed desire to a friend that I wouldn't mind trying to do one of the old houses in Bahay na Bato, a real Bahay na Bato.
This is like a hobby.
Well, I wasn't sure at that time whether it was something I would regret later on. But then all of a sudden, this came up. It was probably half in ruins. And so I asked myself, do I want to do this? And yeah, so we decided, yeah, let's do it.
It took 2 years to restore the 170-year-old structure and bring it up to 21st century standards of safety and comfort, without sacrificing much of the original's design. Aside from modern amenities and a couple's personal memorabilia, the house would look very much like it did a century ago.
We tried as much as possible to make it as close, as possible to how it would have looked like. And fortunately, we met artisans along the way who were acknowledged experts in this field, like the ceilings, and a lot of the paintwork was done by an artist by the name of Guy Custodio, who did a lot of the Bohol churches. He lived in Spain for over 2 decades and mastered restoration paintings.
When the couple are not in town, the house is rented out to families who want to experience Taal in a more authentic way, or as a centrally located base to explore the beaches of Calatagan and Nasugbu. And indeed, Taal Lake, where the Rodriguez couple have another property they also rent out. A charming farmhouse amid sprawling cliffside gardens overlooking the world-famous volcanic lake.
Wow, this is really beautiful. And it's the first thing that greets you when you arrive in the property. It's a side of the lake that very few people actually get to see. You don't just have the lake, a Taal volcano, but you also have this one over here, a front row view of Mount Makulot.
The Ataalaya farmhouse above the lakeshore of Alitagtag, a few kilometers from Taal Town, is quite the opposite of what you'd experience on the, well, opposite side in Tagaytay. No crowds except for the monkeys that hide in the trees below. No noise except for the constant chirp of birds. Nothing that gets in between you and the spectacular view.
In a way, it doesn't even feel like you're in Taal Lake at all because everything just feels so different over here.
It's a private sanctuary up here, especially if you book the entire place for yourself. Now, how the couple chanced upon this piece of paradise is one of those rare cases of serendipity.
It started off when we were looking for a small piece of land for a farm, hobby farm. It took about a year before somebody approached me and said, I have something available for sale. I had to look at it. It was very rough. But yeah.
It was a bamboo grove.
A bamboo grove, yeah.
And then they said, there's the view of the lake at the end. And it was all bamboo. So he said, I don't believe you.
I can't see anything.
There's nothing. So we told them, we'll come back next week. Just cut us a meter so we can walk and see the view. So we came back the next week. Oh my gosh, we saw that. And Mike was kicking me like, don't show that you're so excited because it's gonna go up,
the price
will go up. So okay, it's okay, no big deal. But actually my heart was like this, you know.
Yes, I know. Because it's the same feeling I had seeing the view. The same view you get from almost every corner of this property on the southernmost point of the lake. From the lawn, from the gazebo, from the veranda, and from the upper floor balcony. Surrounded by flower beds and old trees, the house was patterned after a colonial plantation home with charming Cape Dutch design accents combined with colonial Indian and Philippine architectural touches. The home features 5 rooms with common spaces for gatherings and meals, which can be prepared in the kitchen. Even if you shared a farmhouse with strangers, there's more than enough corners in the property to enjoy your privacy and your own private view of the lake.
Actually, most of the guests, they just stay here.
They
don't want to leave. They're just staring and doing nothing and just in the jacuzzi and just going around. It's really more for peace and quiet.
There's only one jacuzzi, however, so make sure to reserve ahead to enjoy sunset. Though, any seat on the lawn could be just as amazing. Evening with a full moon above can be magical too. Even more when dawn breaks and the sun casts its warm glow on the peak of Mount Makulot and on the waters of the volcanic lake. Sunrise is the most scenic time of day here, so make sure you're awake.
The Rodriguezes couldn't have built a better spot for breakfast. Imagine waking up every morning to the smell of Barako coffee. And of course, this majestic view of the lake. And sunrise over there. Every morning, the sun rises on this spot.
The complimentary breakfast, cooked Taal style, is an attraction as well, with a local specialty bonete bread served with barako coffee, and a choice of tapang Taal or tinapang bangus from Balayan Bay. With the bay, lake, and farms, including the Rodriguez's own hobby farm, all close by, there's always good and fresh produce available here, as it has always been in the past. This part of Batangas, after all, has always been blessed with fertile soil and bountiful waters, with navigable waterways conducive for trade. A mix of people and geographical features brought about its earlier heyday, and which, if the current generation of entrepreneurial Batangueños have their way, the dawn of new golden age.
And that's all for this episode of Executive Class. I'm David Celdran. Thanks for watching.